This is the story of one week in the life of Swindon's football team. It begins on Saturday night as they fly back in a charter plane from their away match against Preston. The next match at home is 6 full days away. They're together and for a moment cut off from the crowds. Bert Head became manager when the team was bottom of the third division. Next to him, Mr. Castle, the chairman. On the left, Harry Cousins, the trainer, and Bob Endersby, reporter from the local paper who goes to all their matches. Mick Summerby, outside right. Ernie Hunt, inside right. Bobby Woodruff plays left half. Owen Dawson is a fullback who looks even younger than the current idol Donald Rogers, the left winger, who's 17. The captain, Keith Morgan. The left back, John Trollope. Roger Smart, inside left. Ken McPherson, centre half. And Jack Smith, centre forward. The goalkeeper is Mike Turner.
For the last 3 years, Swindon have made good copy for the press. A side full of 16 and 17-year-old local boys, they played enthusiastic, attractive football. But it was still a surprise to nearly everyone when last season they suddenly found themselves on top of the division. As they fought for promotion, support built up, and the crowds swelled out hysterically with teenage girls and middle-aged women. To the final exultation of their supporters, Swindon eventually picked their way out of the muddy, rugged ravages of third division football. At this point, Bert Head had been manager of Swindon for 6 years and had pursued a single-minded policy of finding local 15-year-olds and blooding them young in league football. Now he found himself a hero and a myth. But there was more to come. This season, as the youngest, newest and cheapest side in the second division, Swindon found themselves leaders once again. One reporter writes, "It took Swindon Town 42 years to get into the second division. It'll take them only 42 games to get into the first. The pressure is on again. Today, they struggle, Saturday by Saturday, with their opponents and with the weight of their own reputation."
The journey back from Preston continues by coach. The match was lost. Home and a disappointed Swindon draw closer.
There was this tension that had been built up. 42 years they'd been in the wilderness, and here was a chance to break out. And the tension grew and grew and grew until it seeped into the boys, it seeped into the crowd, it even seeped into me.
Take this chain from my heart and set me free.
Monday morning. For a side like this and a town like this, for whom success has become food and drink, an essential diet, losing is a bitter thing to swallow. And once swallowed, it tends to get digested. Losing is a thing that finally gets into the blood. If it is in the blood, perhaps it can be sweated out. And they all ponder their sudden loss of magic. Are they overtrained or undertrained? Lazy or tired? So you retrace your steps and try and do exactly what you did when you were winning. Finally, training becomes a ritual dance, a prayer to whatever deity guides a football boot and steers a ball into the net. Most mornings, training is over by 11 o'clock. This is a film of Saturday's match against Preston. Somehow the faults must be found out. Somewhere on this screen lies the answer.
See, somebody there should be coming up to meet him and be getting him out of trouble when he's facing his own goal like this. Now we should be having somebody sprinting. Look, he's got, nope, there he goes now. See, he's streaking.
See, Owen, there's no need for you there, son. You should be moving out to... Might be asking for it. Bit keen looking for it. Moving to your wing. Once again, we get licked in the air. See, we... Look, you see, it's just like chaff, isn't it? Cutter going through chaff. Play it to their feet. There's a man there on mark, look behind there. Breaking quick enough. We're walking. Standing, son, standing. So this is where we get nothing, lads. In this long ball effort, I think we should play our way out of here more.
Apart from special occasions like this, the second half of a weekday morning tends to tail off into odd, aimless activities, like keeping down the pigeons that populate the empty stands.
You know, during the season, we get a couple of wild ones. They get up here and they nest and, then during the rest of the season they roost up here and make a hell of a mess along here. We often get complaints from people about the bird mess along the front here.
It's during this period of the late morning that players and officials pop into the dressing room to have Ernie Hunt cut their hair.
Bit out of practice, ain't you?
Yeah, I don't feel it. I don't have any this week.
No beetle haircut.
No, I can't do the beetle cut yet. Can't do the beetle cut yet.
A bit of a Yul Brynner then.
There's a bit of blood on the scissor, though.
Yeah, sorry then.
My blood.
See, blood on them wing arms. Better wear on the scissors.
About midday, the players drift off home to lunch. For the first team, the day's business is over. Each hour is only significant in that it takes you a little further away from the pain of last week's match and a little closer to Saturday's. In the afternoons, they're free. Donald Rogers, a youth international, leaves the club hostel where he lives for the weekly visit to his parents in nearby Midsummer Norton. Their leisure is not taxing in the ordinary sense. They go to the cinema two or three times a week, drive a little aimlessly in the country, visit the new bowling alley. Mindless pursuits. But a professional footballer cannot afford to be too interested in the world. Their career makes ruthless demands on mind as well as body. All thought, all energy must be conserved. Their lives are in suspension, held in abeyance until Saturday. One or two gamble a little, mainly to break the boredom of the long afternoons. For Bobby Woodruff, it's more of a gesture than a compulsive habit. Always in the public eye, they must conform to public notions of virtue. They may drive a car, provided it's modest in size. They may accept a drink, but only one. And they must return every greeting. They can never really relax. Wherever they go, they are known and watched. They are the focus of pride for an industrial city of 92,000. Their fame renders them vulnerable. The men of Press Steel, of Plessis, of the locomotive yards admire their prowess, resent their freedom and high wages. Ill at ease in their own community, they defend themselves by modesty, decorum, politeness. Luckily, the children admire without reserve. Ernie Hunt, who has played for England's under-23 team, was born in this street and learnt his football on its tarmac. Mick Summerby has shared Ernie's home since they were both apprenticed, and they derive comfort from the cosy atmosphere of this street of industrial back-to-backs. They take full part in all the affairs of the neighbourhood. They buy their chewing gum and receive their tribute of afternoon gossip at the local shop.
Are they new in, Arthur? These are about 6 months old. They specially for you.
These old crumpets over here are
terrible.
Old? No, we don't have anything old here. Not quite as old as the players.
No, all right, that's it.
That's
terrible.
How much is that?
Sixpence, please.
Sixpence. I put some money into this business of yours, haven't I?
Well, I put money in
out there.
I
should be a shareholder now.
It should be.
Go on, give me that money, officer.
No thanks, mate.
No,
you want to have these for tea, then, Aaron?
Yeah.
You want more than that, my lad?
No, that'd be all
right. You sure?
Yeah. For some oxo. We're joining the man appeal.
The man appeal. Right. Hey, Arthur, what's up? You're panicking or something?
No,
put it in a bag.
Window shopping fills out the empty hours. They have steady girlfriends, or like Owen Dawson, marry young. They are neither extravagant nor ostentatious. Their money goes into the bank, into wise insurance policies, on necessary household equipment. The Dawsons are waiting to move into a house owned by the club. Owen is cautious and doesn't even run a car.
Height, 6 foot, muscular.
30 and a half.
Even a tailor's fitting is a ceremonial occasion.
41 and a half.
These ordinary young men, differentiated only by their skill from other youths of their age and station, are Swindon's champions, defenders of the town's good name and reputation. They fulfill and embody a communal dream.
35 and
constrained
a half.
Like this, they must show the courtesy of knights and the remoteness of heroes.
33. 30 and a half.
The traditional trappings of the boardroom are carried self-consciously by the 11 directors of the club, who suddenly find themselves important people, planning new blocks of offices and dressing rooms, and plotting the grandiose scheme for a breathtaking cantilevered stand, which the celebrated Italian architect Luigi Nervi has been commissioned to design for them. And smaller sums are voted away quite casually.
And as it is rather urgent, could we please have a proposition that we'd be empowered to spend this money directly the estimates are finished? Can I have a proposition, please?
I propose to the chairman we do.
I'll second that, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Bill. All those in favour, please show. Thank you, gentlemen. Unanimous, Mr. Secretary.
Friday is a day of anticipation and decisions.
Hello? Good morning, Harold. Tomorrow's team? Do you want all of them? Well, the team is the same as last Saturday, Harold. That is Turner, Dawson, Trollope, Morgan, McPherson, and Woodruff, Summerby, Hunt, Smith, Smart, and Rogers.
No bonus this weekend.
Apart from a bonus for winning and extra fees for playing in cup matches, the Swindon players get a pound for every 1,000 people over 12,000 who go through the turnstiles. This can often mean an extra £15 a week. Donald Rogers, at 17, gets the same as the others. £65 in a good week.
Some of you, Darcy.
All right, John, well, if you put the first team sheet up now, right. and then I'll make the other three out in a moment.
Behind you are always new young players full of energy and ambition. If you drop out into the reserves, your pay can fall by 30, even £40 a week. Saturday morning, the sun's in the sky and the day's full of promise. At his home, not a mile from the ground, Bert Head waits. The hours before the match are marked out by careful habit, by a catalogue of superstition. You wear this suit and that tie, put on the left shoe before the right, sit in a particular chair at a particular time. The players are encouraged to sleep in on a Saturday morning till 11 or later.
Come on, sleepyhead.
At the club hostel, you get your breakfast in bed if you're playing in a match. At 17, you need a lot of sleep to play football. A heavy late breakfast, but no lunch. Bobby Woodruff likes to set off early. He lives in a council house in the village of Highworth, 6 miles out of Swindon. Donald Rogers is unhurried and prepares himself carefully. Between 1 and 2, Harry Cousins, the trainer, makes certain that everything in the dressing room is in its lucky place, that nothing cuts across the players' superstitions. Owen Dawson is practical, serious, and sensible. Except for the football boots and the woolly mascot, he might be setting out for the office. Ernie Hunt and Mick Summerby, inside right and outside right, go off together. On a Saturday morning, the people of the street leave them in peace. Their departure is watched, but unremarked. Bert is on his own. The players at least have each other, and they can eventually sink their fears in the heat of the play. Bert is condemned to sit alone on the touchline. Once inside the guarded doors, you feel a bit better. The untidy but homely arrangement of wooden buildings has the comfort of familiarity. Most of the team have played here and played together since they were 15. Summerby openly enjoys the admiration of the girls. But Ernie Hunt is the favorite. His picture is pinned under the desk lid of many a Swindon schoolgirl. Mike Turner has the brooding and watchful look of a man who dreams at night of letting girls into his net. Keith Morgan is painfully nervous and always sick before a match. The manager is often hated, seldom loved, and always carefully watched.
Bert Head as a manager, I don't think there's a more artful man in football than Bert. Well, he was sat on the bench down here at one game, and he used his real army language. I mean, there's no question about that, and the referee heard it, came over, and said, now cut this bag language out, and the sit on the side of Bert was one of our old players. And he turned around and said to Ginger, yeah, Ginger, I told you not to use that language. Well, immediately, Bert cleared himself. That's what I mean. He's an astute man, and he's very artful.
Some strip early, others leave it to the last minute. They talk and joke and giggle. The soothing smell of hot oil and embrocation fills the dressing room and stops nervous tension turning into cramp. Gradually the noise and laughter subside and they become deeply involved in the detail of preparation and absorbed in their own thoughts.
I think most people feel a little bit nervous, but there's only the occasional person that feels really sick, you know. It's all right once you get out there. Once you get out on the pitch, you're all right. It's just a quarter of an hour, 20 minutes before the kickoff, you don't feel so good. You don't realise you're worrying about it, but inside you know, it's building up gradually.
You got to be fit, let's put it that way. If you're fit, then don't matter how much training you do, if you're fit, well, then you're all right.
lads. All fit? Well done, Owen. Team changes? Know your team changes? Eh? Mason comes in from McDonald, outside left. Owen, quite a good ball player. Converting inside forward, so take it from there. But don't forget today, lads. A little bit tricky, the ground. Shooting a little bit. So if we can get on and crack them, forwards. Ernie? Hey, today's the day. Good. Well done.
Hello? Hello? Copy? Roland R. Blaster, Swindon Advance, copy. All right. Reverting to their regular forward line, Swindon Town were hoping to regain their goal touch against Leighton Orient this afternoon. Point paragraph. Manager Bert Head was banking on them finding their early season form in front of their own supporters.
This job is one of the loneliest jobs in the world. There is nothing so strange and so lonely as walking onto that field and sitting on the bench, knowing that you and you alone have the full responsibility of that side on your shoulders.
The Swindon players draw strength from the crowd. When they look into the terraces, they recognise every face. Their families are there, their neighbours, the boys they were at school with. Leighton kickoff, right to left. The early play is edgy and ragged. Leighton settle down better and take firm command of midfield play. They look dangerous. Pearson intercepts to Summerby.
Ricky, move in! Move in, mate!
Before they get a goal, you can feel the tension in the air of there's something lacking. But until that goal goes in, if it takes half an hour, three quarters of an hour, you're all wishing, you're smoking, everyone's chain smoking, and your foot's moving about, your head's trying to get the ball in there, but once it's in, you're all happy and contented and quite lively.
Owen Dawson back to Turner in goal. Bobby Woodruff to Summerby.
Go with it, son, go with it. Go on, lick him. Go on, boy. Go on, lick him on the outside.
Oh. Morgan intercepts. Summerby, Woodruff, Hunt, Rogers. Rogers keeps it. Ernie Hunt, the scorer from Rogers' pass. The chairman is handed the attendance figures as soon as they're totaled up.
Now, we're not going well at all. You know that as well as I do. Our passing is a little astray. And also, we'll have to move up quicker on our halfbacks, Bobby, both Bobby and Keith, a little quicker, moving up in the gap and taking up the slack. Both Ernie and Roger, you'll have to get up quicker, both of you, and play it out and play it to our wingers. Now, if we start to come round the back, we can go ahead. But at the moment, we're just hanging on a thread, lads. You know that as well as I do. We haven't played well this first half. So when we go out there, right down to it, I want forwards closing in on defenders, not standing off and backing away, etc. Go in onto them, move onto them, and stop them from starting anything. So now, come on, let's see what we can do. John Trollope to take a free kick. Summerby. Ken McPherson clears to Smart. To Trollope, to Woodruff, to Hunt, to Smart, to Morgan, to Rogers. Woodruff, Hunt, to Morgan going through on his own. Pearson stops Leighton again. Woodruff takes it up.
Go, Jack! Jack! Jack!
To Jack Smith. To Hunt.
Swindon Town, 5, comma. Leighton Orient, 0. I'll alter that if it's necessary at the end. Wonder Boy, Donald Rogers, R-O-G-E-R-S, started the rush that ended the doubts about Swindon's ability to stay in the Division 2 promotion race.
The last 90 minutes have consumed the stored up energy of a whole week. The roar of 18,000 supporters has excited them to supreme efforts. Heart, mind, and body have been strained to the limit. Six days of rest and preparation have brought them to this victory. 6 days remain to rest and prepare for the next. 10 short seasons to go and their football will be over. Last year's captain and a former hero of the town is now a clerical assistant. The man who brings on the sponge and the man who makes the tea were among the well-known footballers of their day. The life of the professional athlete is precarious and short. The adulation of the crowd, short-lived.
Rub it.